Welcome to XATA Turnpike. On today's call, we're going to be going over the hours of service aspect of the XATA Turnpike website. The first page of the website that we're going to go through is the DBIR inspection report. This report will display an electronic printable copy of any pre or post-trip inspections that were done by a driver using their phone. To access this report, click on Vehicle Performance, Maintenance, Inspections, and DBIR Inspection. You then will be prompted to enter in a start date, end date, and a group. There are three different ways that you can enter in a date range. You can click on the drop down and select a date from the calendar. You can also type in the day of the month and an abbreviation of the month, hit your tab button, and it will auto-fill in the date. Lastly, there are three shortcut keys that you can use to enter in date ranges. There is the M key, which will give you a date 1 month ago from today. There is a Y key, as in yesterday, which will give you yesterday's date. And there is a T key, as in today, which will give you today's date. Once you enter in your date range, you must enter in a group that you would like to report on as well. You can either select it from the drop-down, or you can start typing it in, and it will auto-fill in. Once you've selected the start date, end date, and group, click on View. In the upper left, there is an icon that resembles an Excel icon. This gives you the ability to export this page of the website to a CSV file. On the DBIR report page, there is a column for vehicle name, vehicle type, driver name, time of inspection, inspection type, results of the inspection, previous DBIR, and safe to operate. There will be one row on the page for each inspection that was completed. To view the details of a specific inspection, click on the Edit Event icon. You then see the details of the inspection. This can be printed off, if need be, by clicking on the print icon at the bottom of the page. The DBIR inspection reports are available on the website for a period of 90 days. On the bottom of the DBIR inspection report is a section for maintenance action, which we will talk about in the inspections with defects report. The next report that we're going to talk about is the Inspection with Defects report. The Inspections with Defects report is located by clicking on Vehicle Performance, Maintenance, Inspections, and Inspections with Defects. The report will display any defective items that the driver selected when they performed an inspection using their phone. This would be a good report for a mechanic to have access to. They could run this report to see what defective items were noted by the drivers for the date range that they select. A start date and end date must be entered, as well as the group the report will be ran on. To enter a start date or end date, you can select from the drop-down and click on a date. You can also enter in the day of the month and an abbreviation for the month and hit your tab button and the date will auto-fill in. There are also three shortcut keys that you can enter in dates with. The M key, M as in month, will populate the date fields with a date 1 month ago from today. The Y key, Y as in yesterday, will populate the date fields with yesterday's date, and the T as in today, will populate the date fields with today's date. After you've entered in a date range, select the group from the drop-down or begin typing in the name of the group, and it will autofill in the name of the group. Once you've entered in the date ranges and the group, click on View. In the upper left, there is an icon that resembles an Excel icon. This gives you the ability to export this page of the website to a CSV file. There is a column for vehicle name, vehicle type, driver name, time of inspection, inspection type, and reason for failure. Reason for failure would be the defect that the driver selected when they performed the inspection. There is also a column for driver note. When the driver completes an inspection, they are prompted to leave a comment on the phone if they choose to. If they leave a comment pertaining to the inspection, the comment will be displayed in the driver note column. There are two ways a defect can be cleared on the phone. The first way is if a driver deselects the defect on the phone. The second way is if a mechanic clears the defect from the website. The next three columns are used by a mechanic to clear a defect on the website. They must enter the mechanic's name, work performed, and the time of the repair. To do that, click in the box preceding the inspection, enter in the mechanic's name, the work performed, and the time of the repair. Note that the time of the repair must be after the time of the inspection. After you've entered in those values, scroll back over to the left and you will see a save icon and a cancel icon if you need to cancel this. Once complete, click on Save. After you've clicked on Save, the defect will be cleared. Once you click on View, you'll notice that that item is no longer listed as a defect, and the next driver that logs into that vehicle will not see the defect listed as a defective item. If you would like to see a list of defects to include any items that have been cleared on the website, place a check mark in the Include Released Inspections box and then click on View. You will then see any defects that have been previously cleared on the website. The next area of the XATA Turnpike website that we're going to talk about is the System Status section of XATA Turnpike. System status can be used to determine whether or not the route tracker that is installed in each one of the vehicles is communicating with the phone, and the phone in turn is communicating back to the website. Before we get into that in detail, let's go through kind of a general overview of how the system works. The route tracker is this little black box installed in each one of the trucks, and it's connected to this ECM via J1708 cable, and it collects two files or messages on the device. The first file is a data file that collects two pieces of information, data from the vehicle and GPS information. Examples of some of the data collected are going to be speed readings, idle time readings, odometer readings, RPMs, and fuel consumed. This data file is transmitted to the phone via Bluetooth and then transmitted to the website via the cellular network approximately every 2 to 4 hours. Now, another message that we collect on the route tracker is used to update the online mapping on the website. And this is going to be a smaller message that contains information such as where the vehicle is located, speed readings, motion, status, and heading, to name a few. This message is also sent to the phone via Bluetooth and then to the website and is sent approximately every 4 to 5 minutes. Now, additionally, the TP Mobile software on the phone communicates via Bluetooth with the route tracker to determine when the vehicle is in motion and when it is stopped and adjusts the driver's logs accordingly. One of the nice parts of the system is that TP Mobile is able to keep the logs up to date whether or not the phone is in cell coverage based on this connection to the route tracker. So if a driver goes out of coverage, the hours of service files are stored on the phone until a cellular connection can be made, and then the files are sent to update the website. So now that we have a general overview of how the system works, let's go to the area of the XATA Turnpike website where we can monitor that system status. So we'll click on system status, and first we'll talk about mobile phone device status. The first thing I have to do is select a group that I want to report on, and then click on view. When the mobile phone device status page opens up, let's talk about the different columns on this particular page. The first column is going to be phone description, and that's going to be a description that you give when you enter the phone into the XATA Turnpike website. The next one is going to be lock status. When you select a vehicle, when you are initiating a pre-trip inspection, that locks in the vehicle to the phone. So the status would be locked. TP Mobile serial number is the serial number that is in the TP Mobile software. When you originally download the software to the phone, you'll be given a TP Mobile serial number that you have to enter into the website to configure it. Location is going to be the last location based on the last time that that route tracker reported back into the website. The last real-time vehicle, that's going to be the vehicle in question. So these last three columns are what I particularly pay close attention to. This is the page that I would visit probably every day when I first started using the system, just to ensure that that route tracker was powered on and communicating and that the phone was turned on and communicating as well. Now the last real-time timestamp, that's going to be the last time that the route tracker reported back into the website. And as we showed in the illustration, the route tracker has to communicate to the website via the phone. Now the last TP Mobile communication is the last heartbeat of the phone. So that is the last time that the phone communicated back to the website. Now obviously if the phone gets turned off or if the phone is out of coverage, then we will lose both last TP Mobile communication and our last real-time communication. Some other scenarios that you may see. If the phone is taken away from Bluetooth range of the route tracker, we'll still maintain last TP Mobile communication providing that the phone is still in coverage, but we're going to lose last real-time communication. An example might be a driver takes the phone inside to make a delivery into a warehouse and is inside for an hour. If that is the case, the last real-time updates are going to stop, but the last TP Mobile communication updates will continue to arrive at the website, providing that, like I said, we are in coverage and that the phone is turned on. Now, if you see the last TP Mobile communication falling behind, then that could be an out-of-coverage issue or the driver could have turned the phone off. The last real-time updates will come in approximately every 4 to 5 minutes. The last TP Mobile communication updates will come in every hour when the phone is in Bluetooth range of the route tracker, and they will come in every 15 minutes if the phone is taken outside of range of the route tracker. So this is the mobile phone device status page, and this is something that you should look at every day when you're first starting out, just to ensure that all facets of communication are functioning properly. Next, we're going to talk about the route tracker processing status page. To access the route tracker processing status page, click on System Status, then Route Tracker Processing Status. You will have to select the group that you would like to report on, and then click on View. The Route Tracker Processing Status page, as you can see, has a column for the unit. It'll have a column for the last recorded GPS time and the last recorded engine time. And when we talk about the data file that we collect from the route tracker that contains two pieces of information, one we talked about was the GPS information, the other one we talked about was the engine time information. Now this data right here is used to populate the performance reports on the website. So this particular page on the website can be used as sort of a troubleshooting tool. If you're trying to run a performance report and you're not getting any data, you would want to look here to see the last time that GPS data in that data file was processed into the website and the last time that engine time information was processed into the website. If, for example, I'm trying to run a performance report for vehicle trial 1, and I'm trying to run it for October 1st, well, we can clearly see that this particular vehicle has not processed any information into the website for a large amount of time. So here back in September, we processed in GPS information. Back in June, we processed in last recorded engine time. So if I'm trying to run a report, a vehicle performance report, for October 1st, it's going to be blank. Now, as far as the colors are concerned on this page, if you see white or gray, that signifies that we have gotten a last recorded GPS timestamp back in at least the last 7 days. Yellow signifies that we have not gotten a last recorded GPS time in between 7 and 14 days. And red signifies that we haven't got a last recorded GPS time in greater than 14 days. Now you'll also notice that there is a row that is in a purple color. And what that is utilized for is if you leave a comment in the comment column, that'll change the color of that particular row. Now, why would you want to leave a comment? Well, here's a perfect example. This truck is out of service. So rather than coming in here every day and wondering why it's not reporting back in, I can leave a note for myself or to a colleague that the truck's out of service. So that's why it's not reporting in. Now, to leave a comment, you just simply click on the plus sign. It'll open up this comment box, type in your comment, and then click on OK. And now it leaves that comment in that column field. To remove the comment, simply click on the plus sign, hit your space bar, and you can't hit your backspace or your delete button. That will not complete the deletion of the comment. You have to hit the space bar and then click on OK. And once the page loads, that'll remove the comment. So once again, this is the Route Tracker Processing Status page, and it's used to troubleshoot the performance reports on the website if you're not seeing data that you think you should.
Driver logs on the XATA Turnpike website are found by clicking on Hours of Service Reports and monitoring, driver logs. A start date and an end date must be entered. To enter a start date or end date, you can select from the drop-down and click on a date, you can enter in a date by typing in the day of the month and the abbreviation for the month, such as 23 November, and hitting your tab button, which will autofill in the date. There are also three shortcut keys that you can enter in a date with. The letter M, as in month, will populate the date fields with a date 1 month ago from today. The letter Y, as in yesterday, will populate the date fields with yesterday's date. And the letter T, as in today, will populate the date field with today's date. After the date field is filled in, select the drop-down next to units and select standard for USA or metric for Canada. Lastly, you must select your driver ID by selecting from the drop-down, or begin by typing in the driver ID, and the driver ID will auto-fill in. Next, click on View. On the first line of the driver log, there is a field for month, day, year, name of company, and company address. Below, on the second line, is a field for driver ID, driver's name, and co-driver's name, which is populated if the driver entered in a co-driver on his phone during the trip. Below that is a line for the vehicle number, which will contain all the vehicles that the driver did pre-trip inspections on for that day. Next is the distance field, which is based off of values from the ECM on the vehicle. So if a truck is mechanical and does not have an ECM, that field will be zero. That value would have to be entered on the XATA Turnpike website under Edit Tools, Edit Driver Log Distance. This entry for driver log distance must be done in order to have a compliant log. Next is the trailer number, which is populated when a driver does a pre-trip inspection of their trailer. This number is required on a driver's log according to 395.8 and 395.15. So it is suggested that your drivers do that pre-trip inspection of the trailer to satisfy those requirements. The next line contains any manifest numbers or route numbers that the driver entered in on that day. Another requirement of the driver's log in 395.8 and 395.15 is a shipping document number, so it is suggested that your drivers enter in a manifest number to satisfy that requirement. The default log rule that your driver is operating under is listed, as well as a line for the driver to sign the log if needed. As far as the driver signature line and signing the log is concerned, during the driver training, we talk about when the driver ends their trip, they are prompted to accept / confirm their logging out of the trip. This is considered their electronic signature of their log. If a driver's log has to be edited for accuracy for any reason, in other words, if a driver made a mistake on their log and it has to be corrected on the XATA Turnpike website, the log must be printed and signed by the driver, as what they electronically signed for when they ended their trip has changed. As a result of this edit, the log will say edited at the top of the log. The signed driver log must be kept on file for the driver for the required 6-month time frame. Another reason for printing and signing the log is if a driver had a violation that day. While not required, it would be suggested as a best practice that this log also be printed and then signed by the driver. There is a note section on the bottom of the log that can be written on by the driver and the driver only once the log is printed. There is also a graph on the driver's log depicting the different statuses that the driver was in throughout the day. There is a line for off-duty, sleeper berth, driving, and on-duty, as well as the totals for each one of these statuses on the right side of the log graph. Below the log graph is a graph that displays the different remarks that were generated on the log, which correlates with the ID column of the remarks section of the log below. In the remarks section, there is the ID column with a timestamp next to it. Under the remarks type column, you will see remarks ranging from TP Mobile login to logout and pre-trip and post-trip inspections of both tractors and trailers. There will be a remark type for auto duty status changes, where the phone changed the driver's status based on motion from the vehicle, as well as driver input status, where the driver manually changed their logs on the phone. Driver input will be a remark type when a driver entered in a manifest or route number, for example. In the location column, you will see a manifest number or route number next to driver inputs and a proximity next to most of the other remark types, followed by a city and state abbreviation. If a driver had a violation for the day, it will be listed in the lower left corner of the log page, as well as any alibis that the driver declared on that day, such as the 16-hour big day.
The driver log summary report in XATA Turnpike will display a one-row log summary for each day in the date range entered. To access the driver log summary report, click on Hours of Service, Reports and Monitoring, and Driver Log Summary. To enter a start date or an end date, you can select from the drop-down and click on a date. You can also enter in a date using the day of the month, the abbreviation for the month, and then by hitting your tab key, it will autofill in the date. There's also three shortcut keys that you can enter in dates with. The M key, M as in month, will populate the date fields with a date 1 month ago from today. The Y key, Y as in yesterday, will populate the date field with yesterday's date. And the T key, T as in today, will populate the date field with today's date. The units field is for standard or metric for US or Canada. Lastly, you have to enter in the driver's ID, and this report can only be ran one driver at a time for the date range that you enter in. You can either click on the drop-down and select the driver from the list, or you can begin typing the driver's ID and it will autofill in the name of the driver. Lastly, we'll select a maximum speed value. So we're just going to put in 25 miles per hour for a maximum speed value. And we will show what that pertains to here in a minute. Now the checkbox for HOS violation must exist. can be checked if only days in the date range that have HOS violations want to be viewed. Once all the parameters have been entered, click on View. When the page loads, you will see an Export CSV link in the upper left-hand corner. This link can be used if you would like to export this page of information to a CSV file. The first column is a date column. There is a plus sign in front of the date, which is a shortcut to the driver's logs. Click on the plus sign to access the driver's logs. After the date column, there is a day column, rule set column, then columns for driving hours, log distance, speed, on-duty hours, available time tomorrow, and hours accumulated. The violation column shows any violations that occurred on the day, and the violation occurrences show any occurrences of those violations. Any of the hours variables listed are in decimal format, not hours and minutes. The log distance is based off of the ECM values to match the driver's log, and the speed listed is an average speed. When a value is entered in on the prior page for maximum speed, that value is compared to the average speed for the day, and if the value entered is higher than the average speed for the day, an overspeed notation is displayed in the violation column. On the bottom of the report, in orange, is the summary section of the report. The fields that are listed are total distance, total hours driving, total hours worked, days with a speed violation, days with an hours of service violation, total hours on duty, not driving, and lastly, average speed. This, once again, is the driver log summary report in XATA Turnpike. The duty status update report in XATA Turnpike is a good report to run to see available time for your drivers. To access the duty status update report, click on Hours of Service, Reports and Monitoring, and Duty Status Update. Place a check mark in front of the checkbox for the group or groups you would like to run the report for, then click on View. The report page has a link to export this page of information to a CSV file if you'd like to do so. There's a column listing the driver's name with a plus sign in front of it. The plus sign is a shortcut to the driver's logs. There's also a column for driver ID, the fault rule set, current status, the driver's available drive and duty time, their rule time remaining for the week, their consecutive time off. There's also a column for the last hours of service record, which is the last status change that has taken place on the log, and also a column for last real time record, which is the last time the route tracker sent a message back to the website. So once again, this is the duty status update page on the XATA Turnpike website, and this is a good report to look at if you'd like to determine how much time your drivers have left. To access the violations report, click on Hours of Service, Reports and Monitoring, Violations. To enter a start date or an end date, you can select from the drop-down and click on a date. Or you can type the date and the abbreviation for the month, hit your tab button, and the date will autofill in. There are also three shortcut keys that you can enter in dates with. The letter M as in month will populate the date fields with the date 1 month ago from today. The letter Y as in yesterday will populate the date field with yesterday's date. And the letter T as in today will populate the date field with today's date. Put a check mark in the checkbox for the group or groups you would like to run the report for, then click on View. Columns on the report are driver name, driver ID, date of the violation, and the violation type. The report has a plus sign in front of the driver's name column, which is a shortcut to the driver's log for the day of the violation. This report is suggested to be ran on a daily basis to stay current with any violations and address them as soon as possible.
The Edit Driver Logs page in XATA Turnpike shows all the different pieces that make up a driver log and is used to make corrections to a driver's log in the event that the driver makes a mistake. Some examples of mistakes you may see are a driver not logging off duty at the end of the day, changing their log to an incorrect log status during the day, or forgetting to enter in a manifest number. To access the Edit Driver Logs, click on Hours of Service, Edit Tools, and Edit Driver Logs. Now, before we enter in a date and a driver ID, the first step is to examine the driver's log to determine what needs to be changed. Once you have figured that out, then proceed to the Edit Driver Logs page to make the changes. At the top of the page here, I have another tab open, and when I'm looking at this particular log, there is an off-duty status during the day that should not be off-duty. So I've determined what needs to be changed, which is this status needs to be changed from off-duty to on-duty, and now I can proceed to the Edit Driver Logs page to make that change. You'll notice at the top of the log once again that I see the month and the day, so I know what day and month I need to input to pull up the Edit Driver Logs page. Now, there are three ways to enter in dates on XATA Turnpike pages on the website. You can click on the drop down and select the date from the calendar. You can also type in the day of the month and then the abbreviation for the month and hit your tab button, and that'll autofill in the date. Lastly, there are three shortcut keys that you can use to enter in dates as well. The letter M, as in month, will give you a date 1 month ago from today. The letter Y, as in yesterday, will give you yesterday's date. And the letter T, as in today, will give you today's date. Lastly, you have to enter in the driver ID. And if you begin typing in the driver ID, it will autofill in the ID, or you can click on the drop down and select your driver from the drop down list. After you've selected the driver, click on View. When looking at the Edit Driver Logs page, you can see an icon to export this page of information to a CSV file if you choose to do so. There is a column on the report for the event date and event type. The event type will contain information such as manifest numbers, if entered, pre and post trip inspections, and duty status changes, to name a few. The details column contains the details of the event type, which, for example, would show different statuses as well as the actual manifest number that was entered. We will go through an example of changing a log status on a log where the driver changed to an incorrect status on their phone. Keep in mind that the goal behind changes made on a driver's log is to make the log accurate. Once again, we look at the log to determine what needs to be changed. So on the 17th, for this driver, we need to change his status from off-duty to on-duty. Back on the Edit Driver Logs page, once again, I can see at 12 o'clock, there is an off-duty status change. This status needs to change from off-duty to on-duty. To make that change, I can simply click on the Edit Event icon for that row. When I click on the Edit Event icon, it'll bring up the Update Duty Status box. What I simply have to do in this example is click on the drop-down, change the status to the correct status, and then I'm required to leave a comment. In regards to leaving comments, use a comment that is logical in regards to the change you just made. So in this example, if the driver incorrectly went off duty for that hour, I could put a comment pertaining exactly to that. After you've input that comment, click on Update. Now you can see here that the line turned green and that the details changed to on duty. Anytime you make a change to a driver's log, you're going to have to recalculate the logs. And you can see that the recalculate button up here lights up in red. Now there may be other changes that you have to make to a driver's log. If there were other changes, I could make those changes. And after I'm done with the changes, then I could go ahead and click on Recalculate. In this particular example, I'll go ahead and click on Recalculate. Now typically you'll get a message here that'll tell you no driving violations have been found. There may be instances where there are violations still on the log, which are legitimate violations, and you'll get a pop-up telling you that as well. So for this example, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to click on OK. Now there are other things that you can do on the Edit Driver Logs page to change a driver's log. We just went through an example of changing one row in the driver's log to update a log status. Some of the other things that you can do is you can insert a status. So for example, at the end of the day, if my driver forgot to log off duty and the last status that I saw was on duty, I could insert a duty status at the end of the day and change that to off duty. Another example would be inserting a vehicle inspection if my driver forgot to do a pre or a post trip inspection. I could insert a manifest number, insert a trailer inspection, or insert a remark. Just keep in mind that any changes made to the driver's log, you have to hit the recalculate button. Now you also notice that when we make a change, there's also a comment that is input into the comment column, as well as the name, the date, and the time of the user who modified the record. These are just some of the examples of edits that can be made. There is also a delete icon next to each row on this page. The delete icon is the red X. If, for example, you inserted a manifest number on a log for the wrong driver, you could remove that piece from the log. When you click on the red X, that row turns red. Once you click on Recalculate, the row will be removed permanently. However, if you click on the red X to delete, but realize you don't need to delete that row, you can click on the red circular arrow to undelete that row. But remember, if you click on recalculate, you cannot undelete. Now it's important to note that any edits that are made on this page will not be reflected on the driver's log on the phone until the driver has logged out of the phone and logged back into the phone. Edits also should not be made while a driver is logged into a trip, as conflicts could occur. There is also an edited only checkbox that you can place a check mark in to only view rows of the edit driver logs page that have been edited. And these are some of the examples of some of the edits that you can do on the edit driver logs page in XATA Turnpike. The edit driver logs distance page on the XATA Turnpike website is used to update the driver's log distance on a driver's log if it was incorrect. If we look at a driver's log, you can see here that the distance value that we see is zero. That could be because it is a mechanical truck. Logs only generate distances for trucks that are electronic, that have ECMs. So, for example, I have a mechanical truck. I need to update the distance on the driver's log. I can go to the Edit Driver Logs Distance page on the website to do that. So to do that, we'll get the day. So this is the 13th. We'll click back on the other tab here and we'll go to Hours of Service, Edit Tools, and Edit Driver Log Distance. We'll type in a date range. There's a few different ways that we can type in date ranges. We can click on the drop down and select the date from the calendar. We can also type in the day of the month and an abbreviation for the month and hit the tab button, and that'll autofill in the date. There's also three shortcut keys that you can use to enter in dates. If you type in the letter M as in month, that'll give you a date 1 month ago from today. The letter Y as in yesterday will give you yesterday's date, and the letter T as in today will give you today's date. You'll have to fill in the units. Units are going to be standard for United States or metric for Canada. And then lastly, enter in the driver ID. You can click and select from the drop-down or begin by typing in the ID and it will auto-fill in the driver's ID. Lastly, click on View. You'll see here when the page is displayed, the distance value is zero for the 13th. And we could see that when we looked at the driver's log. To make that change, click in the box and then change the distance value. I'm also going to have to, in this example, change this to miles from kilometers, put in the value that I would like to have on my log, and then lastly, we have a save icon and we have a cancel icon. So I want to save this. I go ahead and click on Save, and now that distance value will appear on the driver's log. We would have to rerun the log here to have that displayed. Next is the Edit Driver Assignment page on the XATA Turnpike website. Anytime a driver does a pre-trip inspection of a vehicle, a driver assignment record is created. When the driver does a post-trip inspection, then the driver assignment record is closed out. So there's going to be a timestamp and a date for a driver assignment record, and then there's going to be a timestamp and a date for the end of that driver assignment record. Anytime there is a change made to a driver's log, regarding a date and timestamp on a pre- or a post-trip vehicle inspection, the exact same change has to be made under the Edit Driver Assignment Record on the XATA Turnpike website. So if I make a change to the begin time of a pre-trip inspection, after I finish that change under the Edit Driver Logs page, I have to then go in to the Edit Driver Assignment page on the website and make the exact same change. So once again, any change that is made to a pre-trip or a post-trip inspection date and time has to be made as well under the Edit Driver Assignment page on the XATA Turnpike website. Create Driver Log from Trip is a procedure that you can use to take vehicle trip data and convert it to driver log data. An example would be a driver gets into the truck, they do not log in, and they don't do a pre-trip inspection. Throughout the course of the day, as they're driving the vehicle, the route tracker is still keeping track of when the vehicle is moving and when the vehicle is stopped. After the trip comes in, we need to assign that vehicle trip data to the driver so that their log will be complete, because right now they don't have a log. And what we can do is we can use the process for create driver log from trip to essentially plug in that driver's ID to the beginning of that vehicle trip data and to the end of that vehicle trip data to create the driver's log. Next, we'll talk about unassigned drivers. Unassigned drivers report gives you visibility to drivers who are not doing their pre-trip inspections. If a driver is not doing a pre-trip inspection, they're not going to be able to go into drive status on their phone, and thus their log would not be compliant. As an example, I could enter in a start date and an end date and select a group. And when I click on view, any driver who has not done a pre-trip inspection for the date that I entered in will be displayed on that page. So this just gives you visibility in terms of what drivers may not be doing their pre-trip inspections. And obviously that will be a compliance issue if they're not. Now another report page on the website is unassigned vehicle activity. An unassigned vehicle activity is going to be ran by vehicle, and it's also going to give you visibility in terms of what vehicles have not had pre-trip inspections performed on them. One of the differences with the unassigned vehicle activity report is you have a minimum distance value that you can enter in on this particular page. So, whereas on the unassigned driver's report page, if I have drivers who aren't working that day, they're still going to show up on that particular report. So I could run the unassigned vehicle activity report and put in a minimum distance value of 10 miles so that any trucks that are parked and nobody's using them, they won't show up on the report. So that's one of the nice things about that minimum distance value on the unassigned vehicle activity report. Both of these reports, once again, will give you visibility in terms of what drivers are not doing pre-trip inspections and what vehicles have not had pre-trip inspections done on them for the date range that you are entered. And once again, that comes down to a compliance issue.